Hello and welcome Dr. Sushma Singh this side in chapter 4 social justice. Let us start topic John Rawls' theory of justice. If people are asked to choose the kind of society in which they would like to live, they are likely to choose one in which the rules and organization of society allot them a privileged position. We cannot expect everyone to put aside their personal interests and think of the good of society, especially if they believe that their decision is going to have an impact on the kind of life and opportunities their children will have in the future. Indeed, we often expect parents to think of and support what is best for their children. But such perspectives cannot form the basis of a theory of justice for a society. So, how do we reach a decision that would be both fair and just? John Rawls has tried to answer this question. He argues that the only way we can arrive at a fair and just rule is if we imagine ourselves to be in a situation in which we have to make decisions about how society should be organized. Although we do not know which position we would ourselves occupy in that society. That is, we do not know what kind of family we would be born in, whether we would be born into an upper caste or lower caste family, rich or poor, privileged or disadvantaged. Rawls argues that if we do not know in this sense who we will be and what options would be available to us in the future society, we will be likely to support a decision about the rules and organization of that future society which would be fair for all the members. Rawls describes this as thinking under a veil of ignorance. He expects that in such a situation of complete ignorance about our possible position and status in society, each person would decide in the way they generally do, that is, in terms of their own interests. But since no one knows who he would be and what is going to benefit him, each will envisage the future society from the point of view of the worst off. It will be clear to a person who can reason and think for himself that those who are born privileged will enjoy certain special opportunities. But what if they have the misfortune of being born in a disadvantaged section of society where few opportunities would be available to them? Hence, it would make sense for each person acting in his or her own interest to try to think of rules of organization that will ensure reasonable opportunities to the weaker sections. The attempt will be to see that important resources like education, health, shelter, etc. are available to all persons even if they are not part of the upper class. It is of course not easy to erase our identities and to imagine ourselves under a veil of ignorance. But then it is equally difficult for most people to be self-sacrificing and share their good fortune with strangers. That is why we habitually associate self-sacrifice with heroism. Given these human failings and limitations, it is better for us to think of a framework that does not require extraordinary actions. The merit of the veil of ignorance position is that it expects people to just be their usual rational selves. They are expected to think for themselves and choose what they regard to be in their interest. The pertinent thing, however, is that when they choose under the veil of ignorance, they will find that it is in their interest to think from the position of the worst off. Wearing the imagined veil of ignorance is the first step in arriving at a system of fair laws and policies. It will be evident that rational persons will not only see things from the perspective of the worst off, they will also try to ensure that the policies they frame benefit the society as a whole. Both things have to go hand in hand. Since no one knows what position they will occupy in the future society, each will seek rules that protect them in case they happen to be born among the worst off. But it would make sense if they also try to ensure that their chosen policy does not also make those who are better off weaker, because it is also possible that they could be born into a privileged position in the future society. Therefore, it would be in interests of all that society as a whole should benefit from the rules and policies that are decided and not just any particular sections. Such fairness would be the outcome of rational actions, not benevolent of generosity. Rawls therefore argues that rational thinking, not morality, could lead us to be fair and just, impartiality regarding how to distribute the benefits and burdens of a society. In his example, there are no goals or norms of morality that are given to us in advance, and we remain free to determine what is best for ourselves. It is this belief which makes Rawls' theory an important and compelling way to approach the question of fairness and justice. Here we close our today's lecture. Thanks for listening.